Larry, Larry, Larry. Republicans are supposed to cut taxes and cut spending, not cut taxes and increase spending. I mean, with Republicans like this, Larry, who needs Democrats?
I think Mick Mulvaney, by the way, gave a wonderful answer. I just think
why he's totally going against all his traditions and his beliefs.
He's giving his conscience out. No question about that. I thought the worst part of this, by the way, was the two-year deal. Two-year deal was even worse. The Trump budget is not so bad, but it has to incorporate the two-year deal, which was very bad. That was $300 billion, broke the caps, broke the sequester, and all the rest of it. However, there's a lot of tough stuff in the Trump budget that's probably not going to pass. I mean, they are going after large and small entitlements. That's the Rubicon. I don't know if they get that through the House. I hope they can. They're going into things like SNAP and food stamps and so forth. They're going to tighten eligibility requirements. So I wouldn't say nothing. I just say, you know, Mick is from South Carolina, and he's a tough guy, and he gave a very clever answer.
Rebecca, $1 trillion worth of government paper. Rick Santelli is going to be so busy for the next couple of years as the government borrows and borrows and borrows. And that's what interest rates have been telling us that the market is worried about.
And I'm more and more worried about it. And I'm worried that this will be one of those things that it doesn't matter and the market doesn't care until suddenly it does. Right. So basically, between the last fiscal year and this fiscal year, the amount of borrowing the U.S. needs to do is effectively doubling. It's an inflection point. It is a sea change in the economic regime we're in. So we have the Fed reducing its balance sheet. We have talks today on trade with China. What if China, one of the biggest holders of our debt, decides it's going to diversify a little bit and have a bit more European debt instead of U.S. debt? Who's buying these bonds and at what yield?
History lesson, Mr. Kudlow. Take me back to the Reagan years.
Yeah.
Not a non-analogous set of circumstances.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Large tax cuts.
And interest rates.
Interest rates were much, much higher than they...
And they went down, down, down.
And they were coming down. But the other thing was a large increase in military spending, increase in spending. What happened to deficits?
Deficits went up, okay? And they're going up here, although not as bad as some people are making them out to me. Look, here's my take. I don't think deficits have much impact at all on interest rates. I think that's never really been proven. First point.
Doesn't crowd out.
You're just talking about global economy with a couple of hundred trillion of savings floating around. So that's point number one. Point number two, the deficit is going to be about 5.5% for fiscal 2019. Mm-hmm. Okay, I think that's the right number.
5.5% of GDP.
Yeah.
Correct.
Over 10 years or so, going to average about 3.5% of GDP.
Much lower than it was at the height of the financial crisis.
We ran, and in Reagan years, we ran 6% to finance tax cuts and military spending. So I wouldn't panic over that. Look, one way to look at this, some people will disagree, I get that, but you're investing in the economy. The first couple of years, the deficit is going to go up. The tax cut is an enormous investment in a stronger economy. I would make that point. And the military investment is also an investment in our national security, which we need. So in that sense, growth is going to rise. And I think over time, this whole deficit picture is going to look much, much better.
But Larry, I'm interrupting you. Interest rates are going up because the economy is growing and
yes.
we have modestly rising inflation, I think you can have higher yields and higher equities and we're all kumbaya. If interest rates start going up because supply is going up and there are jitters about the buyers or at what yield the buyers come in, I am less confident that those rising yields are going to be kumbaya for the stock market.
See, I think the rates are going to go up. I totally agree.
To where?
We've talked about this. With a stronger economy, let's say 3-4% economy, real interest rates are going to go up. Mm-hmm. At least 100 basis points.
To 3-4%.
That's great. Closer to, I would put the range at 3.5-4.
On the 10.
On the 10-year. So the 10-year is a 2.80 and change.
By the end of the year?
No, it's 2.80 and change right now.
No.
Right.
3.5-4 by the end of this year.
Well, I don't know what the timing is, Sully.
And that
I
matters. It's a good point, Brian.
Well,
because
we always hear
matters.
It's not the level.
It's the speed.
It's the speed of gain.
And that's absolutely true.
And I don't know that. I can't predict that. It's very hard. But, yes, the warning is out there. It's very hard for someone with my view to say the correction's over because I think a lot of the correction was based on the jump in market rates, two-thirds of which is coming from real rates because you got higher real returns in the economy, and about one-third is coming from inflation. We've said this. I don't know if anyone paid attention. Right. We've been talking about this for quite some time.
But, Larry,
stronger economy raises rates. It's a natural phenomenon. Yeah. I'm okay with it.
So budget deficit, 5.5% of GDP next year. That is quite big. Oh, no, no, no. You say that, but the last two recessions, the budget deficit has worsened by 7 percentage points. So we're going to go into the next recession already at 5.5%.
Well, I don't know
So what do we do? What do we do to help ourselves?
Rebecca, look.
Even in 2001, you're I love you, too.
But I don't think, of all the measures I can think to drive rates, one of them is not the deficit. Real interest rates and inflation basically drive long-term rates. Even the Fed doesn't drive long-term rates.
But the budget deficit goes hand-in-hand with the current account deficit, which is going to give us a weaker dollar, which is going to push up interest rates faster because of inflation.
Actually, I would reverse that logic. I think what's going to happen over time, all right, is that the trade deficit is going to get larger because we're growing faster than the rest of the world, while the budget deficit gets narrower as we grow faster here at home and throw off more revenues. I don't think there's a link between trade deficits. We had this argument during the Reagan years. But never worked.
Tell me you're mad about the increased spending, Larry.
I'm
like
furious.
This whole discussion has been about why it's okay. It's not okay.
It's not okay. I want to see the details of this budget. I haven't had time to comb through it. I will, as an ex-OMB green eye shade. I want to see what's troubling Mick Mulvaney. I want to talk to him. They didn't get their budget from last year, which was very tough. I don't think they're going to get this budget either. So you need larger Republican majorities to get that. One thing is, a lot of talk about infrastructure, this number, $1.5 trillion. The president is saying a couple hundred trillion the government will see.
A couple hundred billion.
A couple hundred billion, rather. You know, they put in $20 billion last year for the two-year window, or this year for the two-year window. I just think these numbers and the whole infrastructure program has to be fleshed out. We really don't know yet what they're going to do. And we're not going to have reciprocal taxes and tariffs. He won't go there. Reciprocal conditions, yes. Reciprocal taxes and tariffs, I don't believe it. I really don't believe it. It's a negotiating card. That's just my take.
Thank you. Thank you, Rebecca. Thank you, Larry.
Thank you, Rebecca.
Thanks.
Hey there, thanks for checking out CNBC on YouTube. Be sure to subscribe to stay up to date on all of the day's biggest stories. You can also click on any of the videos around me to watch the latest from CNBC. Thanks for watching.